Pastor Bruce Wall live on Boston Praise Radio and TV. I have on the line Dr. Stephen Davis, who is calling in from the Calvary Gospel Church in Newark, New Jersey, where the pipes burst and the water flows. Dr. Davis, how are you this afternoon?
Listen, we want you and the folks over there at Global Ministries. We're having a pool party and barbecue today. It's 37 degrees.
Yeah. You know, it may be warm, but yesterday Renee walked into the church. So, you know, we had our water burst on last week.
Uh-huh.
And the studio, I don't know if you saw the photos, but the studio was filled with water.
Yes, I did. Uh-huh, right.
And so we were able to use the wet vacs. We had two wet vacs, and we cleaned up all of that water. And you will never know. Doesn't even look like we had a flood here. Everything's mm-hmm. all dry, and we're mm-hmm. back to order. So Renee walked into the studio on yesterday. Monday is my day off.
Uh-huh.
And so she called me panicking, and I said, what's wrong? And she told me that we had another water leak right outside of my office upstairs, and the water was pouring like a waterfall. And it started on the third floor bathroom. The pipe burst, came through the second floor ceiling, went all the way down to the first floor to the kitchen, and completely wiped out the ceiling in the kitchen is gone, completely collapsed, and the half of the ceiling upstairs is gone, and half of the ceiling on the stairs. What a mess. Mess, Stephen.
Oh, tell me about it. Uh-huh. Fortunately, our water lines in the basement collapsed. And fortunately, everything was in the basement. So we didn't have any damage to other parts of the building. When you have a 130-year-old building, you know, around the same time that you were born, you know, things happen. So that's what was going on.
Mm-hmm. Well, has it all? Did you have to call someone to clean it up?
Fortunately, the drains took care of the basement.
Okay.
And but yes, had to call a plumber in who also happens to be part of the church, who does this great work for us at phenomenal prices.
Amen.
So we thank the Lord for that.
Amen.
But
Amen.
You know, just because it's a balmy 37, and I'm told by Friday it might get as high as in the 40s here.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the dawning of a new day. Now, I don't know if you have on your television screen and if you can see the new look of Bruce Wall, but we...
hold it.
A new look, and the wife is saying you need to do something with it. My wife told me I look like Father Smurf.
You do resemble him. Mind you, I was not going to say anything about that.
Okay.
You know, but now that you've started it, mm-hmm. You do look like Mr. Smurf and company.
And usually when a person grows a beard and just lets it grow wild,
mm-hmm.
they're always going through something. There's something happening.
Mm.
And I think I started this when I was waiting for a decision from a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And now that I have this decision, it's all anticlimactic now. I don't know what to do with it. So I'm just letting it continue to grow. And listen, last Sunday for service, we had a little incident in that I walked into the church at about 7:30, and I came through the hallway, which is usually very cold because there's no heat in the front hallway. I walked into the church, and I said, the hallway feels like the church. So I went and looked at the thermostat, and the thermostat said 30 degrees.
Oh, goodness.
The entire
Lord.
Church.
Uh-huh.
So I said, this has happened once before many years ago, where we didn't have any heat. The furnace died on us.
Mm-hmm.
And what we did is that we still had service for about an hour in Buttry Hall, the small room where we eat.
Right.
And you could see as people were breathing all the air coming out of the
Oh my goodness! That's just entirely too cold.
It's a little bit too cold. So yeah. what we did is that we set up chairs in the studio, and because it was a cold Sunday anyway, and we knew we were not going to have the largest crowd, so we packed people in the studio and we had them outside of the studio, and we had the service right here in the radio station.
Yeah.
And we did it live, and so it was on the FM side of our station. Usually we're just doing the television upstairs, but we did everything, and it was a very interesting time. It was a good service. I really enjoyed what God said to us and what God did. But oh my gosh, it was cold in this place.
Oh, you know, it's funny you mention that. This past Sunday, we were at a balmy 6 degrees, and the sanctuary only got up to like around 60. And the thing you're trying to explain to people is that, listen, when you have an old building and when it is 6 degrees outside, you know, it's, you're not, you know, you're not going to reach 70 degrees inside. But it was great. Usually on the first Sundays, the ministerial staff and myself, we wear our robes. And it wasn't a problem with me having on my robe on. I had my my suit jacket on underneath the robe as well. So I was...
you were good.
I'm telling you. Yeah.
It was an experience for us, let's say. And the plumber came, and the way he... Actually, we put a ladder up to the ceiling. And then I saw him take out a hammer. I said to myself, what is he going to do with that? And the next thing I knew, he was pounding on the ceiling, and then everything started dropping to the floor. So you had the water, now you had this. I said, oh, my gosh.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my gosh. So Renee and I were the only two here because a majority of our people work. We have very few people who are retired, so we're the ones here. So we just spent the entire day just cleaning up the floor, mopping the floors, and it, what's really funny is that when people come in on Friday or on Sunday or on Saturday and they look at it, they're gonna say that's not too bad. All they're gonna see is a little hole in the ceiling that we covered over with plastic, with black plastic bags temporarily, and because this time we said, we need to call the insurance company. We can't take this one on ourselves. We can't take this hit. And but usually insurance companies, some of them, we hear the stories that sometimes they want to drop you when you file a claim.
That's true.
After you spent thousands of dollars with them.
Tell me. Yeah, they will. They will try to do that, regarding on how big the claim is. And you know, fortunately. We, a few years back, picked up Church Mutual.
Yeah, which
is a great company. And, you know, really understand when we have incidents like this. Fortunately, we haven't had to make a claim, which maybe that's why they're so good to us. You know, but, you know, those are some of the things that, you know, they never taught you in school.
No, they didn't.
No, they didn't, you know.
And I'm thankful that I'm a hands-on. And the reason, here's the other thing. The reason why there was no heat in the church, our oil is delivered automatically. So they, I guess they just predict and they bring the oil. Well, because it was so cold last week, we put the, which was, I never do it this way, but we put the thermostat on 68 and said hold. So it ran at 68. During the morning, ran at 68 at night. That we were done. We have two tanks of oil. Was done in 1 week, which is unprecedented. That was $900 gone in 1 week.
Tell me about it.
That's crazy, Stephen.
Listen, we've just changed over here at my house. We ran oil. For the longest, and Not even 2 weeks ago, we switched over to gas. Because it was, you know, our oil company sometimes, you know, wouldn't make it. And not recently, but I remember the oil ran out of the furnace, and it was 7 degrees outside. Mm. And, oh, my God. And I guess it was just so cold. It was absurd.
Any pipe problems?
Fortunately, not. Fortunately, in each room in the house, mm-hmm. we also have an electric heater.
Okay.
So that really saved the day. And even with, and again, you know, my house was built in 1916.
Mm-hmm. When you were born?
No. Right at the time that you had gotten your bachelor's degree. Okay. So you know, of course, you know, they're planning to do the siding and the insulation. But right now, you know, when it's cold outside, it's mm-hmm. cold. It can really get really cold. And when it was like 6 and 7 degrees, yeah. the thermostat was saying, you know, 62. You know, the radiators were, you know, were blazing. So I don't even want to look at what the gas bill's going to be.
Oh my gosh! Yeah, when I was told that it was $900 in 1 week, I said, "Oh my
gosh." I hear you. Yeah, and sometimes you know, we'll have that. Fortunately, you know, now with the house on gas, we. You know, you don't have to worry about deliveries unless you just become that crazy and haven't paid your gas bill, mm-hmm. you know. But you know, that's one of the things, that we have to deal with, you know, in the Northeast where, you get these weather changes. And I had a friend of mine who was on Facebook and telling me from Nashville, Tennessee, I woke up this morning, it's 2 degrees. Mm. And
In Nashville. Interesting.
Yeah. The South, you know, the South suffered.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they suffered. But, you know, we want to make sure, you know, if you and Pickles want to come down to the pool party and barbecue. Mm. Because we're celebrating this balmy 37 degrees.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Well, I'll take it. We have had no more water problems. Now, the other funny thing is, for me, at the house, mm-hmm. so all of my children are home.
Ah.
And so the two boys moved back in. And so before it was Karen, myself, and my daughter, and we can control the heat.
Uh-huh.
So I didn't want to look at the heating bill. So I just didn't look at it for 30 days. I went into 30 days and 2 weeks, and I still hadn't looked at the bill. I was paying all the other bills. And I said, you know what? Karen's going to be ticked if the electric company comes by and padlocks the, you know what I mean? So I looked at it the other day, and I said, okay, let me look at it. And so I looked at the bill,
mm-hmm.
and I hadn't made it. This is going on the second month. I hadn't made a payment.
Oh, Lord.
And you ready?
Uh-huh.
In my brain, I was saying 900. You know,
uh-huh.
It was zero.
Get out of here.
In May, or April or May, I wrote a check to the electric company for $1,000.
Uh-huh.
I just wrote a check for $1,000, which far exceeded my bill.
Uh-huh.
And since that time, it's just been dwindling down. It's been eating off that $1,000.
Uh-huh.
And so I didn't have a bill. I haven't had a bill in months because I wrote the check off for $1,000. So I said, hey, it's uh-huh. zero. Let me write a check for $500 and let it
uh-huh.
sit there.
Yeah. So hold it. You let your kids move back into the house?
Unfortunately.
See?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, my God.
We changed the locks.
That doesn't work. They will hire a locksmith to come and take the locks off.
No, we changed the locks and everything. You know, once you leave, you know, you sign an affidavit that you won't be coming back.
Mm.
You turn in your keys, and, you know, then you could do, you know, you could, oh my goodness, your food bill will go down.
So one day one of my sons was in the kitchen and he opened up the refrigerator.
Uh-huh.
And he said, "You guys have no food here."
I'm telling you.
I said, "You had your own apartment. You were living on your own.
Uh-huh.
What did you do then?"
Uh-huh.
"I went to the store and I bought food." "Well, you better go to the store and buy some food."
You know what mine did?
What?
He took our food and went home with it. So now you know that, and the funny thing about it, I don't recall doing anything like that when I moved out of.
I moved out, I was gone.
Uh huh.
You know, they had to beg me to come back for dinners. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I don't get this. I really don't get it. But hey, they're our children. What else are we going to do?
I'm telling you,
this is so funny. I would look at, I'm so used to buying food and the things that I like and putting it in the refrigerator. Now, I want to buy my own little refrigerator and put it in my bedroom.
There you go. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Because, as you were saying,
right?
They come to the house and they walk out with the food.
That is
hilarious. That's funny. Because I'm the one beefing about it. My wife is the one that says, let them take whatever they want.
That must be a woman thing. My wife does the same thing. You know, I'll say, "Do you see what he did?" So I don't know. Fortunately, I have a study in the basement, and I have my own refrigerator down there.
Oh.
Uh-huh. So I could stash all of my snacks and everything.
That's where you put all your Pepsis and ginger ales?
There you go.
Okay,
there you go.
I'll know that the next time I come out.
Oh, my goodness.
You are not going to contain me. I'll just sit in the living room in the corner all by myself.
Well, you know, you're free to go into my refrigerator once you get the combination. and you're more than welcome to have, 2 ounces of Pepsi and everything. And that's the funny part, you know, with the kidney, I can't drink dark sodas.
Oh, yeah.
So my side of the refrigerator is 7-Up, ginger ale, and the only dark soda I could drink is root beer. Because of the phosphorus content. And on the other side of the refrigerator, there are the Pepsis. And when my wife was in the hospital, I know that Pepsi stock went down, because she's a true lover of Pepsi.
What is the difference between, I know people are listening and saying, what's wrong with these two guys?
Uh-huh.
What's the difference between Pepsi and Coca-Cola from your
Nothing. Perspective? They're all made from the Coca plant.
But the taste is different.
Yeah, uh-huh. But now remember when Coca-Cola was first made, they used cocaine. That might answer some of my questions. I grew up drinking Coca-Cola. I was told that Pepsi was too strong. But I love a glass of Pepsi every now and then. Love it.
Well, for those of you who are listening, again, I'm talking to Dr. Stephen Davis. I'm Pastor Bruce Wall. This is Boston Praise Radio and TV, and this is, I call this afternoon inspiration. And in another, I'd say, 6 minutes, we will be going to Richmond, Virginia. We'll be broadcasting in Richmond, Virginia, and we're hoping that many of you will stay with us as we go there and continue our behavior with that listening audience.
You know what? We can call this first half hour the gripe session.
And the second half hour?
I don't know. Inspiration. We could do that, you know.
We need some type of inspiration.
Yeah, right? after we gripe so much, you know, we have to go into the inspiration.
The Holy of Holies.
My goodness. But I have some great news is that I have paid off Christmas 2005.
Wow.
I don't have the financial resources that the Walls have. You know, we just preach a rich gospel. You know, we don't have that and everything. But
well, it's funny. My wife didn't put up a Christmas tree. This is the second year.
Really?
She took a mannequin, okay, that she uses maybe to make a dress or something. She took the mannequin and wrapped Christmas decorations around it, and that was our Christmas tree. To put a little angel at the top. That was
sacrilege. Sacrilege.
Yeah, but it saved some money.
I'm sure, but I must have a real Christmas tree. Right. No phony one that stays up in the attic or in the basement for 11 months or so. I must have a real Christmas tree.
See, you guys don't know how to live on the wild side.
No. Had one, always had one as a kid. I think one year when we lived in Virginia, we had a fake tree. I don't know where that thing is. I might have, I'm sure it's thrown away, but no. Now we must have, that's my declaration. That must be a real Christmas tree.
Well, the other thing I did when my son moved back into the home, this is so funny, I went and I told the story of how I knocked over my 65-inch television set on the glass. And so I went and purchased a new one because they had all kinds of sales, and I had a great sale. And it was funny, when I went to purchase the TV, my son was home with his computer, and I was saying, tell me about Samsung, and tell me about Sony, and tell me about LC, and tell me about CPI. And he was doing all the research for me. We finally decided we were gonna go with Samsung.
Uh-huh.
He came to the store. I made the purchase. I went and I was gonna write the check out. No, I gave my credit card and he gave his credit card. I said, "Son, what are you doing?" He says, "I'm paying for half of it." I said, "No, you don't have to do that. This is mine. It's good." He said, "No, I didn't get you anything for your birthday." So I said, "That's good." Now that was son number two.
Uh-huh.
So I brought the TV home, had it installed, and put on the wall. And what did I do? We had a nice couch put downstairs. We had a nice reclining couch, and that was my man cave.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Okay.
I better tell the story quick because we have to go to the other station. So when my son came home to live, he started hanging out in my man cave.
Oh, my goodness.
Guess who owns my man cave?
Your son.
My son owns the man cave.
This is Jeremy that's doing all this.
No, this is...
Aaron doing all of this?
Yeah, the Aaron man, yeah.
He's got the man cave.
So I said to Karen, well, I guess we're just going to have to take the living room and dining room and create something up here. She said, no, you won't.
Oh, goodness.
And we can't talk like this in Virginia, but 2 minutes to go.
Mm-hmm.
Why do the wives feel that they can say to you, I decorate the house, just pay for it?
Listen, after nearly 42 years of marriage, I haven't figured it out yet.
Have you given in?
Well, my son's former room is now the girly room.
Okay.
And that's Denise's room now. Okay. So my son,
that's her hangout
now. Okay. Yeah, and she has all this stuff. She bought furniture for it. Last Christmas I bought her a television for it, so that's the girly room.
Well, what they have given me is I have an office downstairs in the lower level, and I have some clothes in there, and I have my computers, and that's about all that they gave me. They said, that's your confined space. From here, from here to here, from here to here.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But when you come out of that room, the rest of the house is mine.
Uh-huh.
I Stephen, I don't know what we're going to do about
it. I don't know. I'm thinking about trading her in this year anyway.
A new model, like a lease car.
There you go.
Okay. I'm going to make sure that she receives a copy of the broadcast.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, this is being recorded.
I know.
It is going up to YouTube.
I've been surprised sometimes by seeing a broadcast that you and I have done, you know, on Facebook. What? And, you know, I mean, not recently, but
Well, we'll tell you the story. We'll tell you the story about why. Well, I can tell you now. I have 1 minute and 32 seconds, and we have to go to station. Station ID. So, if you are on Facebook and you allow music to be played, if it's not yours, if you do not have the rights, they will not allow you to put any videos on.
Really?
Right now, my penalty is I can't put any videos on for the next 30 days.
Oh, my goodness.
And so what we've decided to do was not to go on Facebook for our videos anymore. We're telling people, go to our website.
Yeah.
This is our website. Let's build our website.
Sure.
You know, we can play music. We'll do what we want to do because we have a license to do it. And we're not going to allow Facebook to dictate to us anymore because it's becoming real frustrating to have them spank you, put you in a corner, and tell you for the next 30 days you can't do anything on our page. So,
oh, goodness.
So what we will do is send the broadcast once they're done. They'll go there, but we're not going to actually broadcast there anymore.
That makes sense.
Okay, it's 21 seconds, and we're going to get ready to go to the Virginia station ID. And when we come back, you and I will be more serious.
We'll be
very spiritual. And we'll speak, we'll be using the King James language. We'll be right back.
Let me hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
This is Pastor Bruce Wall from the Daily Inspiration Radio and TV broadcast in Boston, Massachusetts. I cannot wait until we step into the praise and teaching of the Word of God. I hope and pray that you are ready for what God is going to do in our lives this afternoon. Again, we are the Daily Inspiration broadcast on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network of radio and television stations operating out of Boston, Massachusetts, across the country and now around the world. You can reach us at 670 Washington Street in Dorchester, Massachusetts, zip code 02124. 670 Washington Street in Dorchester, Massachusetts, zip code 02124. You can reach us on our webpage at www.bostonpraiseradio.tv. You can reach us via email at bostonpraiseradio@gmail.com or by calling us at 617-282-0685. That's 617-282-0685. Now let's prepare our hearts for what God is about to do as we worship together and study the Word of God.
Well, this is Pastor Bruce Wall. We have a new format here as we are broadcasting in another city. We're broadcasting from the studio at the Global Ministries Christian Church. We're located at 670-670 Washington Street in Dorchester, Massachusetts. And we're thankful that you have chosen to be with us. Dr. Davis is actually with us, and I'm going to bring him in right now. Dr. Davis, are you there? Ooh, he can't hear me because the music's playing. Dr. Davis, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, tell people something about your church, because we're now in Richmond, Virginia.
Okay, hello to all of our friends in the Richmond area. The Calvary Gospel Church was started 70 years ago here in Newark by a gentleman and his wife who were just recent college and seminary graduates from Wheaton College, and actually wanted to start a church, and decided to start it in Newark, New Jersey, one that would emphasize not only Jesus' lordship, but the work of the Spirit of God in the life of the believer. And that came along back in 1947. And we have been in Newark. This is our second location. We've been in this location since 1964. I came to this church as a teenager in 1967. Came to know the Lord in this church. Was part of the church youth group and the evangelistic arm of the church that we ministered across the country as teenagers. Went to school, came back, married a girl that I met in this church, and we're looking forward to what God is going to do for us in 2018.
Well, and I'm Pastor Bruce Wall. I pastor a church, the Global Ministries Christian Church in Boston, Massachusetts, and I've been here for 25 years, watching a ministry go through a lot of transition, and we have our mission statement is that we are to reach the lost for Christ and to create a Christian community where believers can heal and they can mature and walk as whole men and women. And we have been attempting to fulfill that commitment for the time that I have been here. And Dr. Davis and I have become lifelong friends. I met him when he was you were a teenager, weren't you?
I was a young teenager.
And what are you trying to say about me?
You were old then.
I was old. Then.
And you ready? When I think about it, we're pushing close to 50 years.
Yeah.
And you were old then when I was a young teenager.
And that's 50 years of combined ministry of 100 years
that's right.
of ministry. It's amazing. One of the things that I've said to Dr. Davis is his youth group used to go into the streets in New Jersey and other places around the country.
Yeah.
And they would sing and they would witness to people in the streets.
Mm-hmm.
And when they came to Boston, their pastor was a white pastor.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a racially mixed church.
Yes, right.
A racially mixed church. And to see these young people in the streets of Boston ministering and reaching people really touched my heart. And one of the things that I said to myself is that I want to see a choir similar to that here in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had developed a youth choir that traveled around the country and actually was involved in gospel music and gospel plays. When we have had our concerts, we would actually have a play in the middle of the concert, and then we would actually give an altar call. So
right.
a lot of that inspiration was my seeing these young people be very bold. We also took our youth group, Dr. Davis, to one of the housing developments, one of the poorer housing developments here in the city, and we would bring a ball and a jump rope, and with that we would attract young people to come out of their houses, and we would play games with them on the weekends and reach them for Christ. We would have karate demonstrations and a lot of games for the young people. God did a lot in my life as a pastor, but what he did in the lives of the young people to go to the streets where they lived and to reach people, young people, their peers for Christ, it changed me and transformed me. So, you know, you and I could tell stories about how your church taught us something and about how our church taught your church something. It was what I call cross-fertilization, and it worked.
That's funny. I've never heard it put like that, but you're so right. But the thing that always amazed me about you, Michael Haynes, and those folks up there at 12th Baptist is that you folks always took it to the next level. I remember, definitely was in the early 70s. Dr. Haynes preached here. And, you know, he preached here, and he was complaining about how he was struggling to find an audio engineer.
Okay.
And he took that, went back to 12th, and I'm up there, and I'm looking at this room, you know, that's looking like a studio in CBS or NBC, mm-hmm. and, you know, you folks were always able to take it to the next level, and that's mm-hmm. one thing that that I've always admired about you and others, you know, and here we are now, and I really don't know if the folks in Virginia really understand that this is a black-owned, black-controlled radio station, mm-hmm. that there are no, not that we wouldn't accept or that you wouldn't accept, you know, white folks, but, you know, usually you have a radio station and you have whites who are in control, and they will even tell you what to do, what to preach about, so on and so forth. And that's not like that here. You've taken it again to the next level, and I thank God for that. Mm.
Well, you know, we have a very conservative Salem Communication radio station that I used to be on here in the Boston area. And I enjoyed my time there. Mm-hmm. Their radio reach was 2 million people. They reached, and it's a AM station. I would go every Saturday at, I believe it was 6 p.m. We did an hour broadcast, and the phone lines would continue to ring off the hook. I had to bring someone to answer the phones. Mm-hmm. The engineer in the studio could not even handle the phones. So the engineer just did the work of keeping us on the air, and I brought in different people each week to man the phones. And then we also did a broadcast at a restaurant, and we went to the restaurant, set up with a TV camera, and set up our apparatus, and we broadcasted from the restaurant. And we had an idea of we wanted to invite people to come in. So the restaurant owner set up tables and put tablecloths on the tables, and people would come in, order their food, and sit down and watch the broadcast. And so we did that for a number of years. And so God just opened up so many doors. And then we, at the Salem Communication Station, WEZE Radio, what they did is that we would broadcast Monday through Friday, five nights a week, and we broadcasted from 11 p.m. until 12 midnight. And they gave us a great rate, and we call that the Church of the Midnight Hour. And on Monday nights, I would actually broadcast from my sanctuary. We would open the doors of the church, and we would broadcast, and we didn't really have more than five people there, but people kept calling the phones. And there's a story of a young man who was driving his automobile through the community, and he was estranged, separated from his wife. And he saw her in a car, and he began to pursue her because something was bothering him, and he was going to do her physical harm if he had stopped the car. But while he was pursuing the car, he was going through the radio station, and he found our broadcast at 11 p.m. at night. And he listened to the broadcast, and he turned his car around from pursuing his wife. He drove to the church. He came into the church and sat down and listened to the entire service. And again, there were just three of us in the pulpit. We rotated the preachers, and I had one lady who answered the telephone, so she stayed busy with the phones. And after service, he gave us a donation. He said, "Thank you, because had I not listened to the program tonight, I would have pursued my wife, I would have done bodily harm, and I would have been in trouble." And then after the broadcast at 12 midnight, the three people and I would go into the streets, and we would try to talk to the prostitutes that were in the streets and to try to win them to Christ. And we did that for quite a period of time. But we were able to use radio as an evangelistic vehicle tool, and that's what we're doing with this radio station. Now, for those of you in Virginia and in other neighboring towns and communities, we're broadcasting from the lower level, the basement of our church here in Boston. And we are excited because we're on 30 different platforms. And God has opened a door for us to reach many people, not only in our city, but we're reaching people in other cities and now all over the world.
Uh-huh. I think that's just fantastic to see from whence you've come and to see, you know, what has happened and how God has opened doors.
Mm-hmm.
For that, where, you know, you're broadcasting from where you are and you're reaching people. And, you know, some folks might be struggling with issues of life right now.
Mm-hmm.
And this broadcast might be their saving grace. So I think that's tremendous and nothing but an answer to prayer.
You know, the other thing that I found kind of exciting is I preached at your church a number of Sundays ago. And when I came back to Boston, on my Facebook feed, I saw your service, the service that I preached at. And I saw the message. And I was just amazed at how you have picked up on technology.
Oh, yeah.
And you're utilizing Facebook as a way of being able to now broadcast your service every Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
For example, on this past Sunday, because we had no heat in the church, for the people who stayed in the small room, we have electric heat in here.
Mm-hmm.
Many of the people who did not come out to the service were able to watch the service live on our webpage.
Great.
And for those of you who are listening to us, you can actually watch us and hear us at bostonpraiseradio.tv. bostonpraiseradio.tv, and you'll see a television screen, and this is how people watch our service on Sunday mornings when they're not able to be here.
Uh-huh.
One of the other things that I did, my mother-in-law is actually, she had a stroke, and she lived in New York by herself, and we brought her to Boston, and she was living and staying at our house until she couldn't walk any longer, and so she went to a rehab facility, and she was missing the fact that she could not go to her church any longer in New York because now she's living in New England,
right,
up in the Boston area. And so one Friday night, I surprised her, and I went to the rehab center where she's living, and I brought my iPad, and we broadcast our prayer meeting every Friday night. And so I set up the iPad. She said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, in just a few moments, you're going to be in a prayer meeting." And she was able to watch and listen to our prayer meeting. And I picked up the phone, my cell phone, and I called into the prayer meeting. And I gave her the phone, and I said, "Everyone's sharing it, their testimony. Why don't you share yours?"
Wow.
So she shared her testimony. Now, what was exciting is that there was a white brother at the facility who was there watching it. And he said, "I want to say something. I want to say something." And then I said, "Sure." And he took my phone and he said, "You black people." And I said,
uh-oh.
He said, "I love your services and I love to listen to the music."
All right.
And he just shared his testimony. And it was just, I couldn't have planned that, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And the people at the prayer meeting were praying for him and praying for my mother-in-law.
Amen.
And it was such a powerful time to use an iPad, an iPad.
Yes.
And so the other thing that we're thinking of doing is having somebody go to the facility on a Sunday morning so that she can actually be in the service through the iPad.
Ah, that's something. You know, I remember when we would try to do the cassette tapes for those who were sick and shut in. And now here we are. We can actually bring the whole service, you know, for someone who might be in a situation similar to your mother-in-law. God bless her. She's a great lady. I thought of her yesterday. I had to go out to Comac, Long Island. My wife left her purse at home, so I had to drive out to Comac, Long Island, and we went through Junction Boulevard and everything, and that's where where your wife used to hang out at. Mm-hmm. So God bless her for that she is still with us, and she's just a great lady.
Mm-hmm. Well, for those of you who are listening, if you have any innovative ways of how to reach people, for example, we're broadcasting also on Roku TV and Apple TV. We have our own television channel 24 hours a day, 7 days a week we're broadcasting. And one of the recommendations, Dr. Davis, that they've made is that you need to buy a Roku receiver, attach it to a TV, and put it in the main room where the seniors gather, and they can actually watch your service live. And what happens is that the people who want to watch it will watch it, and those who do not don't have to stay. But it's a way to broadcast your service and give people who cannot leave the facility an opportunity. And what really touched my mother-in-law's heart was that the people in the prayer meeting spoke to her in live time. You know, so she was watching TV, and they're calling her name, and they're praying for her, and her heart was so warmed and touched people in a prayer meeting in another part of the town, took the time to speak to her.
That's great.
For those of you who actually do this, I'm going to ask the question, does your church do this? Does your church reach people in a very innovative way through radio or television? You can call us here in Boston. This is a live broadcast. It is the 9th of January, and it's 2:49. We're in the studio, Dr. Davis and myself. And if you could call us and let us know how you are reaching people in your community, how you are reaching seniors, how you are reaching people in your neighborhood, it would be great to hear from our friends who are in Virginia and neighboring communities and neighboring states. 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685. You give us a call, and we will answer the call here in Boston. We're not in the studio at our FM station and AM station that we're broadcasting on, but we're in our studio here in Boston, and Dr. Davis has actually called in from Newark, New Jersey, and we have him on the line. He's going to be with me now on this broadcast every single Tuesday starting at 2:30. And we would love to hear from our friends on this radio station, 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685. I know we have some very creative and innovative brothers and sisters who are listening to the station and who are listening to this broadcast faithfully every single week. 617-282-0685, that's our number. Give us a call. We would love to hear from you. What innovative things are you doing? Does your church do to reach lost people for Jesus Christ, to reach seniors who cannot come out any longer? The other thing that we have going on here, one of our pastors, what he actually does is that he goes into the jail, and the local jail, and he's doing discipleship classes in the jail, and he's been showing Christian movies in the jail. They have allowed him to be able to show Christian movies, and a lot of the inmates are listening to our radio broadcast, and so they're able to purchase a headset, and they put the headsets on, and they're able to listen to Christian radio, and that's exciting to know that our broadcast in lifetime is touching so many men and women. We actually may have a phone call. Let's see if this is a caller. Caller, go ahead. You're live on the air.
It was the first time only that we took longer.
No, okay.
Hello, caller? Well, someone actually is on the line. Why don't you go ahead and share about how you use Facebook for your broadcast, and I'll see if I can reach this person. Dr. Davis? Yo, what's exciting is Dr. Davis.
Yes.
Can you share a little bit about how you're using Facebook to reach people?
Well, you know, the thing that I was going to say is that you, and you're not going to blame you, you know, you brought me into all this stuff. One thing I didn't realize, how inexpensive it was. I mean, yes, there's some costs, but I was quite surprised by how inexpensive it was to do that. And I know there are many churches in that Richmond area that they are creative, and they have done tremendous things on with radio. So I know, you know, that's this is just the next door that they need to open. One of my members would just, right when I would start to preach, or one of our ministerial staffs would start to preach, she would start setting up this camera.
Mm-hmm.
And I, what, you know, what's going on? You know, maybe she's recording and everything. And she said, oh, no, we do this, and it's on Facebook. And then I started looking on Facebook and started seeing some of our members, some across the country. I never will forget, one person said, it's great to be home. And she was in Las Vegas, Nevada.
Wow.
And she was looking at the service. And so, you know, I like to believe that Facebook is just that first step that we need to take.
Mm.
So that we can do, really at this point, they only do the preaching part. But I want us to be able to do it where, you know, the singing, the choir, so on and so forth. So it's just been amazing.
Wow.
You know,
wow.
To me.
We actually, someone did call, and I wasn't fast enough to pick up the phone. So, caller, if you'd like to call back, I'm actually going to be in the studio for another hour. You can call back. And, again, it would be great to hear from our friends who are listening to us on this radio station, because the same way that you and I, this cross-fertilization,
mm-hmm.
what you were doing in Newark, New Jersey, touched the city of Boston. What Boston was doing touched Newark, New Jersey.
Absolutely.
Now we want to be able to have our friends in Virginia speak to us about what they're doing,
uh-huh.
so that we can learn from them and they can learn how we in Boston are reaching a large population of people
mm-hmm.
through radio and television and going in to the prisons, because Reverend, who is actually doing it here, the pastor who's doing it here, has just become a chaplain. He's been so faithful in going in that they have made him a chaplain here in Boston. And now when the inmates are leaving the jails, they're coming to the church.
Yes.
And because they want to know, do we really believe everything that we have been saying that we believe in? Will we care for them? And we're not able to do it as efficiently as we want to, but the pastor who is doing this
mm-hmm.
On the church's behalf and on his ministry's behalf, he's learning how to do it, and
mm-hmm.
he's teaching the church how we could be more engaged. We have a minute and 19 seconds before we are finished with this broadcast. And next week, I hope that we can actually have a Bible study between you and I. We'll
sure.
just open the scripture and share that
sure.
with
that'd
those
be,
who are listening.
That'd be great. Uh-huh.
Why don't you give us our final comment? You have a minute.
All right, I have a minute. God bless Boston Praise Radio and Dr. Wall and what he has been doing. And we thank God for how we see how he has worked these things out through the years. Folks, the answer is Jesus. The answer is having him as your Lord and Savior. Not church, but a relationship. Not religion, but a relationship. And I trust that if you haven't, that you will come to know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. And I know I only used maybe 30 seconds of that, but for the rest of you, God bless you.
Amen.
And God bless this work.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Davis. We will be talking next week, and we'll get together beforehand and figure out what passage of Scripture we'll be teaching so that we can be efficient with our time and reach people. God bless you, my friend.
Sounds good. See
okay.
you soon.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye.
617-282-0685 is the number. I'm in the studio. Give me a call, 617-282-0685. Thanks for listening today, And thanks for being a part
of it. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for staying with the broadcast. Thanks for listening to the music and listening to the teaching today. If you're not a Christian and you want to become a Christian believer, you want to have the Holy Spirit live inside of your life, I'm going to read some scripture verses. The first is Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We have all sinned. Pastors have sinned. Priests have sinned. Great people have sinned. We have all, like sheep, we've all gone astray. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Oh my gosh, when I became a Christian in 1967, I finally rested. I rested emotionally. I rested spiritually. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." John 3:16, "For God so what? He loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever," key word, "believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." You need to believe in Jesus. You will not perish. And when you die, the Bible says that you will have everlasting life. Here's one more. John chapter 6, verse 37. "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." Do you want to make that decision today? Do you want to come to Jesus? Well, why not, wherever you are, pull your car over to the side, bow your head, let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear Father, I thank you so much for the message today. Thank you for touching my heart. Thank you for touching my life. And thank you for changing me. Now I want to believe in Jesus. Now I want to confess my sins, the fact that I'm separated from you. And I want a relationship with you, God, through your son, Jesus. Now, Father, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for receiving me. And thank you for bringing me into your family. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've prayed that prayer, you have made a decision to be a follower of Christ, to believe in Jesus, that he died for you, that when you die, you'll have everlasting life. Welcome into the family of God. If you've made that decision today, I want you to give me a call at 617-283-9561. 617-283-9561. Give me a call. Tell me that you've made that decision. Or email me at
The Voice of the Church in New England. The views and opinions expressed by the following paid program are those of the program producers, and they do not reflect the views and opinion of Boston Praise Radio, its staff, or management.
You can hear us on Audio Now, which is radio by phone. Just dial 712-770-7534. That's 712-770-7534, and you will hear us live on your telephone.
Hi, this is Mike D of the UA7 Gospel Countdown, Urban America's 7 biggest current songs and more. Join us in fellowship with our broadcast on www.bostonpraiseradio.tv, Roku TV, WRCA 1330 AM radio, and WBPG 102.9 FM radio. These TV and radio networks are all coming out of Boston. Radio and TV that cares about Boston and beyond. This is yours sincerely, Mike D, of the UA7 Gospel Countdown. Tune in and be blessed.
This is Renee Wise, station manager for the Boston Praise Radio and TV network of 30 radio, TV, social media, and internet stations. You can broadcast on our network by just giving me a call, 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685.
I don't care what I accomplish in my life.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you join us here on the platform in welcoming Jesse Duplanta?
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a big God bless you. Come on. Oh, you can do better than that. Come on. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Well, shake somebody's hand. Tell them you love them. Then you can be seated. Glory to God. The Lord is here today. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you for allowing me a portion of your time today. It's always a high honor. Let me just tell you, so I'm just opening my heart here. When I first started ministering with Brother and Sister Copeland, God is my witness, when they asked me, I thought I might maybe preach one of these conventions at the most, which is honor, and that's it, you know. And just never thinking. And now, 17 years later, 17 years. You know, because I'm not a man, I'm not an assumer of things. And I thought, what's his high honor that, you know, I was asked to minister, and that was it, you know. But the Lord just, I tell you what, it really helped me and helped my ministry. But what helped me more, I needed a friend. And I mean that sincerely. I know a lot of people, but I have very, 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 very few friends. Due to I don't have time to make friends. I'm traveling all the time. And Brother and Sister Copeland have become personal friends. We call it a low maintenance friendship. We love it. We may not see each other we might not talk for 6 months. And all of a sudden we see each other, we just pick up where we left off. You know, you ever had so many people, how come you didn't call me? You know, you know what I'm talking about. But everybody running and doing so many different things, but it's just so wonderful and nice, and it's just such a blessing. So, Sister Gloria, thank you for once again allowing me to grace this pulpit. And I heard she did a bang-up job. Give her a hand, guys. Somebody already told me. Oh, Lord, it's good. Hallelujah. If you got your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 6. I started something, and I'm going to go down there if I can. I started something and at the West Coast. I'm going to finish it here if I can. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I just feel taller at this one. I need all the help I can get. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 6. Hallelujah. And it's just such a... And my wife is here. Kathy, if you'll stand up, give her a hand clap. This is Kathy. Praise the Lord. Bless her. Me and Kathy have been married 37 years. Isn't that something? Now, I know I've had people tell me before I had my own aircraft, they thought my first wife died and I married my second wife, Kathy. Because I look 20 years older than her, but I'm just 3 years older, just that my hair is so white and hers is whatever she wants it to be. And that's just the fine. And that's all I'm going to say about that. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's fine. I don't really know what it is. She just been like that forever. Hallelujah. Shut up, Jesse. Let's go to work here. Matthew chapter 6. I want to read the most famous prayer, I guess, in Christianity. And I want to deal with that in my day sessions. And I'll do something different on the night that I minister. But I'm tired. Let me preface this in saying this. Not long ago, I was in a convention. There was four other speakers and me, all at the same time. Now, you know, going on at this thing. So, and I was the last one to come up. And they asked us to just say a few words, and before the meeting would start. And I said, okay. So, and all four of them got up and said, God gonna do this. God gonna do that. Lord Jesus, God. And people screaming, when you get that whooping, ha, going at, God gonna do this. God gonna do that. I'll tell you, God gonna do this. When they came to me, I said, when? I am tired of gonna. When? How many of y'all agree with me? I mean, I'm glad God is going to do something, but Lord Jesus, I need something done today. You understand what I'm saying? I'm tired of going. I'm tired of putting faith in the future. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:1, now faith is. It's a now thing. It has the ability to create a future, but it's made for now. Because you don't need any of this stuff when you get to heaven. You don't need no money when you get to heaven. You don't need health in any way, shape, or form when you get there, because there's no way you could ever get sick. So we need it today. Do you agree with that? And God agreed with it, and Christianity, it went right over religion's head. And I want to read this verse in Matthew chapter 6. We'll start reading with verse 9. Well, verse 8. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. Verse 9, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done where? Where? As it is where? Now, God means what he says and says what he means. Amen. His will be done in earth, on earth, however you want to say it, as it is in heaven. But let's just face it, that's not happening. And sometimes, every once in a while, but the Bible said, and he put it in red so you couldn't miss it. His will be done in earth as it is in heaven. I want to talk in my day sessions about living out the will of God on the earth today, because I don't need any of this when I get to heaven. Now look what it says, our Father. It starts off with our Father. You got to know who he is. Not a father, not some father, but our Father. That means we're not servants. That means we're sons and daughters. We're family. We're la familia, like you said. Our Father. So he tells us who he is, who art in heaven. So you got to know where your dad is. You got to know that. So in heaven is where he is and where he is on earth. He's in both places at the same time. You have to understand that we can mess up something in heaven today by what we do upon the earth today. What? Oh yeah, we can mess up something in heaven. Because what happens here a lot of times determines what happens there. The Bible said what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, right? What you loose on earth. So notice that you are affecting heaven's economy and heaven's way of doing things today in Fort Worth, Texas. Oh, this is going to be good. Lord Jesus, do you hear what I'm saying? Why? How can you do that? Because you are a family member just living in another place. You understand that? That's why I won't be. I don't want you missing any of my sessions because I've got more light on this thing and it's going to help you. So I realize that what I do can determine what an angel will do on earth as well as what an angel will do in heaven. Did you get that? Because Father God in heaven, Father God on the earth, Christ in you, hope of glory. So our Father, that's who he is, not a father or some father, but our Father. In heaven where he is and where he is on earth, in you, hallowed be thy name. Notice he said, hallowed be thy name. So his name, write this down if you can, his name is equal to himself. Because when the Lord gave us power of attorney to use the name of Jesus, that's as if Jesus was standing right there and says, this is what I command. So his name is equal to himself. That's why he said, hallowed be thy name. It's a precious name. My God, it's a name of power. And we have the power of attorney to use that name. Amen. Which means you become that person when someone signs a power of attorney over to you. If Brother Copeland, Sister Copeland would give me power of attorney over their personal affairs and this ministry, I could sell it all because I would become Kenneth and Gloria Copeland. Simply by a piece of paper. That's how powerful a power of attorney is. That's what the Lord gave us. I'm preaching, Ben, y'all shouting. Are you listening to what I'm saying here? Now, I'm talking about living out the will of God in the earth. I ain't talking about when I get to heaven. I'm not there yet. I'm dealing with what's happening here today or tomorrow. So his name is equal to himself. He said, hallowed be thy name.